Earning the provision God has provided.
Okay. Very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Saying, you know, we're so happy to have everyone here, and we're very gracious that you were able to come and honor us with your presence, and we do formative, as well as an opportunity to share ideas, you know, in order to really further our understanding. The way I look at it, right, we all live in the same little neighborhood, we all go to the same grocery stores, we run into each other at the banks, let's at least know who we are. You know? So with that understanding and with that intention, you know, as Al-Hamad had mentioned, you have the schedules there in front of you. We're going to go through it rather quickly to try to maintain pace and leave as much time as possible for what we hope will be a very vibrant Q&A. So we really want to give an opportunity for everyone to be able to ask questions, get clarification on some things that you might be thinking about from the Muslims directly. Because there's lots of sources you can get. I would say the very best would be this particular stage up here. So please do take advantage of that opportunity. If a question comes to mind throughout the afternoon, you know, just jot it down or make sure you keep track of it, because we really want to get to answering as many of your questions and concerns as possible. With that, I would request us to move upstairs. We're going to take a small tour of the actual Islamic prayer hall upstairs. We're welcoming you all in there. One quick idea that we do request people to remove their shoes. So if you have socks on, that's fine. You're barefoot, that's fine. Just at least the shoes in order to maintain the sanctity of the prayer area. We like to get it. There are going to be shoe racks both for the ladies upstairs, who some of our lady volunteers will be guiding, and in the prayer hall upstairs that our brothers will be guiding there as well. So we do ask you, we can start transitioning upstairs, and I will address you guys again once again. Thank you. So we have our ladies upstairs. Hopefully you guys are getting acquainted and walking around the space. We have our brothers here downstairs. That's usually the first question right off the bat is, you know, why are the men in one area? And to go ahead and put that one to rest, I'll answer it right off the bat, because that's usually my major concern. That with regards to our Islamic rites and the acts of worship, one of the overall concepts in Islamic belief is that of modesty. So in general, Islamic belief, this permeates into our dress code, it permeates into the way we interact, gender interactions, the way we work, the way we pray, all of those things. So the idea behind separating the genders during worship services is so that we can focus specifically on the act of worship. Typically, right, when we're around the other gender, we tend to act a little differently. And this is a natural human nature. You know, when you're, I don't need to get into too much detail. But the idea of it is, for the reason for the segregation of the genders during our prayer services, as well as in our daily lives, is in order to focus better on our true purpose, and that is worshiping God every year. So in a few moments, we're going to have the call to prayer. As many of you may already be familiar, or may not be, and that's why you're here to learn, that five daily prayer services. So in every day, there are five obligatory prayers that a Muslim observes. This would be the second of the five. So there's an early sunrise, there's the second prayer, which is the mid-afternoon, and then there is a late afternoon prayer, there is a sunset prayer, which is fourth, and then there is an evening prayer, which is fifth. Muslims are encouraged to observe those prayers in congregation. And they'll always exchange the as-salam alaykum, wa'alaykum as-salam, peace be with you, peace be back unto you. That general sense of community is ingrained in your daily life, and just becomes part of your rotation, part of your daily time, that you're always, you know, regularly attending. So here you're going to see that Muslims have gathered somewhere, not obligatory, so in a voluntary manner, they're praying towards Allah, and you need to be prepared, just a warm up. And then at 1:30, there are specific times throughout the day where we will all gather for the prayer leader, and he will lead the prayer service right then. Generally, you know, looking around the actual prayer space, it's a very simple area. You don't see a whole lot of decorations. Some of the mosques maybe that you've seen in the news or even in movies, you know, very ornate decorations, gold writing on the walls, which is all acceptable as well. Particular spaces regards to worship. You'll notice as well, that when we actually begin the prayer service, which I want to kind of explain, because if it's your first time visiting a masjid or mosque, it can be a little bit shocking, that this prayer service in particular is silent. Some prayer services are in, right? A lot of us, our knowledge of Islam doesn't go much further than in movies and hit TV shows. Where you usually hear recitations of the Quran, those are in the evening. So those prayer services in which recitation of the Quran occurs out loud, those are usually in the evening times. This, in the afternoon, as well as the mid-afternoon prayer, are silent. But you will hear a repeated statement, Allahu Akbar, meaning Allah is greater. It's an open-ended statement, which basically means that Allah is greater than everything. So you leave it open. This is a linguistic skill in Arabic. And we say Allahu Akbar, Imam, telling the participants that we're going to enter the next posture. There are a few postures during the prayer. We will line up first. There will be the call to prayer, in which we will arrange our rows. This entire center is facing towards Mecca. Many of you know that is basically the birthplace of the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, the Prophet Muhammad. We'll get into more of the details, hopefully, as we get through the presentation itself. But the entire congregation will face one direction. The Imam will begin the prayer with the statement of Allahu Akbar, as the congregants will then enter into that state of prayer. And then Allah, in which we will enter a bowing position. Some remembrances we mentioned in that position. Imam will state another phrase in which we will stand, and then the Imam will say Allahu Akbar again, and then we'll go into a full prostration. A full prostration where our foreheads will be on the ground. At that time, we're all reciting a certain remembrance. That phrase is be to Allah, my Lord, who is the highest. This is quite significant, both physically as well as spiritually, and that it's a place where you are literally the lowest you could possibly be. And you'll notice, right, when your forehead's on the ground, absolutely humbled. And in that position, you then take the name of God and remember that Allah is the highest. So we, our position as human beings, being servants of God, and God in His Majesty being our master. And then the Imam will say Allahu Akbar, and we will repeat that in a sitting position. Allahu Akbar will go back to the prostration. That will be repeated for four cycles. There will be four cycles of standing and prostrating. At which time the Imam will close the prayer with that statement that you heard before, As-salamu alaykum and As-salamu alaykum. And that will conclude the actual congregational prayer service. Afterwards, just give you guys a heads up because I'm going to have to be in the prayer service also. So after the prayer is done, I'll come back. If you guys have questions, thoughts, we'll share a little bit here. But then we want to go right downstairs after the remaining prayers. So hopefully everyone feels a little comfortable. People are going to start filing in and having their volunteer prayers now stop to close off the lights and give everyone a few moments just to reflect and then gather their thoughts. So please make yourselves comfortable upstairs, make yourselves comfortable down here. And we'll be beginning the actual prayer service in just another minute.
Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Ashhadu anna Rasulullah. Hayya 'alas salah. Hayya 'alas salah. Hayya 'alal falah. Hayya 'alal falah. Qad qamat as-salah. Qad qamat as-salah. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. La
leave any gap in between, is that the Lord? سميع الله سميع الله سمع الله الله أكبر السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
Hopefully, inshallah, as we say, that we work for the betterment of the society. Now, usually, before I start the main crux of the presentation, I give each single one of you a short quiz. Are all of you ready for it? Yeah, come on. All right. We have five questions. All right, we have five questions. Anyone who gives the right answer, you get an extra falafel. There you go, they like it. All right, so let's start with the very first question here. By the raise of hands, raise of hand, what do you think is the right answer? Yes, ma'am. B, a mosque. Who wants to be a millionaire? That could be the $100 question. Give her a big hand. That is the right answer. Who do you think Muslims worship? Raise of hands. You want so many falafels? Come on, get one. Let's get somebody else.
Muhammad,
Muhammad, peace be upon him. How many of you agree with that, that Muslims worship Muhammad, peace be upon him? Just raise of hands. We are down to three choices now. D, guys, is that your final answer?
Yes.
All right, give her a big hand. Muslims, we don't worship Muhammad, peace be upon him. We don't worship Jesus or Abraham. We worship God, and in the name of God, in Arabic, is Allah. I asked the same question to a colleague of mine in the hospital. Hey, Joe, who do you think Muslims worship? Of all the answers, the one that he picked, number C, Buddha. Come on, dude, you should know better. So we worship God in Arabic, it's called as Allah. According to the Guinness Book of World Records and UNESCO, which university is the oldest continuous university on the face of this earth? Raising of hands. Mike, you know the answer. You're not eligible in this, all right?
All right.
No, you can raise your hand if you want. Yes, sir. A. Al-Azhar. We are down to four. Right. Yes, sir. C. Is that a guess? That's the right answer. Give me a big hand. Good job. The University of Qarawai, this is in Morocco, in the Muslim country of Morocco, built in the year 859 CE. Way before Harvard and Oxford and Cambridge and all the campuses that we are aware of, this one was built in the country of Morocco, and you'll be surprised to find out that this was built by a Muslim lady. Of all the misconceptions, yeah, give her a big hand, right? Yes. Her name was Fatima Al-Fehri. She was 20-something, she was a youth. The reason we have that important slide is because there are so many misconceptions people have about Muslims and ladies and they're suppressed and all these things. Actually, Muslims, the ladies in Islam, they are given some obligation to gain education. So taking that to heart, they were the movers and the shakers of the society, and this is just one example of that. So in case if you see some Muslims or some people out there preventing Muslim girls and the ladies from gaining education, dismantling their schools and colleges, and placing photos from them getting education, that is their culture. That is their misunderstanding. They are brainwashed. And this is what Islam teaches. To gain education from grave, to gain education from cradle to grave. That is one of the sayings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Number four. Which country do you think recognized USA the very first time of all the countries? Yes, ma'am.
A. Morocco.
Morocco, give her a big hand. She got it. All right. Good job. How many of you pick number D? No, right? No one. All right. Who do you think started Islam? Raise up hands. Yes, ma'am. Give her a big hand, she got it! Alright, was it a guess? Was it a guess?
No, I read the poster over there.
You cheated! No, that's the right answer. In Islam, we don't don't have any founder. It is not Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. It is not Abraham, it is not Ishmael. We say that Islam as a guidance was given by God to the very first human, Prophet Adam, peace be upon him. The same Islam, the way of life, was given to different prophets and the messengers, including the last one, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So God is the one who gave the guidance of Islam to humanity. Muslims around the world, which country do you think is the most populous Muslim country in the world? Indonesia, right? 200 million Muslims. The reason we have this map over here is because there is a misconception out there that Muslims are Arabs and Arabs are Muslims. Out of the 1.7 billion Muslims who are out there, only from the Arab background. I'm a Muslim. I was born and raised in India. My wife sitting up there, she's from Pakistan. So majority of the Muslims, they are from the Indonesia or the subcontinent of India. Right? Only 19%. So how many of you are from the Arab background here? Muslims? 1, 2, 3. You guys are in a minority, guys. We still love you. You are still our brothers and sisters. These are some of the faces of Islam around the world. A Muslim can be anyone from the Hispanic background, African background, India, Pakistan, Australia, America, Chicago, Villa Park. As long as a person professes that I believe that there is only one God, Allah, and I believe that Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. Once a person says that and believes that and makes an intention to follow the beliefs and the main pillars of Islam, that's how a person becomes a Muslim. Could be from any background, nationality, race, culture, becoming Muslim. Islam in the USA. What we will do now is, we will take a short info, we will take a short commercial break now, right? And based on the misconceptions people have out there, especially thanks to, what's his name, Trump? Yeah, our favorite candidate. I'm just paraphrasing. That Muslims have not done anything in the world in the history. You know, and Miss Universe, she also parroted the same comment. So this short video is going to highlight that the contributions that Muslims have done in the USA in the last 3.5 centuries. All right, so let's take a look at this.
When the Haiti earthquake happened,
They went there, they were one of the first people, and they treated 10,000 patients right after, like in the first few days. So in all different spheres of life, all different venues, each one of them, they had impact on the society as being Muslim Americans. So it's very important for us to know that important aspect. Now, coming back to Islam, by the way, how many of you have heard the word Allah before? So it's important that when we speak about the word Allah, we don't mean a different God. We don't mean the God of the Muslims or a tribal God or a God of the Arabs. We mean the same creator, but just so in Arabic language, we call him as Allah. Like in different languages have different names for God. In Spanish, what is the name? Dios, right? In Norwegian language, it is God, G-U-D. But in Arabic language, the creator, his name is Allah. So Allah has many different attributes which are mentioned in the Quran. Some of those attributes are that he is only one in one. So as Muslims, we don't believe in the triune concept of God. We believe that God is only one. We also say that God is the only creator, he is eternal. That means he doesn't have any partners, he doesn't have any sons and daughters and uncles and aunts. He is one, he is unique. We also say that God is the one who is sustaining us. You know, the wonderful food that you ate, the oxygen that we are breathing, the resources that we have, he is the one who is sustaining us, but he himself does not need any sustenance. He is the forgiving, he is the merciful, he is all-knowing, he is all-powerful. So these are some of the attributes of God which are mentioned in the Quran. So before you leave today, we have some gift bags up there. Can you see them, right? Those are the gift bags which are for all of you. And in there, each one of you will receive as a gift from the Muslim community an English translation of the Quran. Right? So there's a special gift coming from all the Muslims over here, and especially this wonderful mosque over here. Along with that, in the gift bag, what else do we have? We have a short biography of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And we also have some brochures in there. Just to understand, just for your sake of understanding that what Islam teaches, what is the gold standard of Islam compared to what people may be saying about it. So it's important for us to educate about each other. So one important attribute of God is that God is a loving God. So in Arabic we say that God is Al-Wadud. He is all-loving, he is the source of all love. So let me ask you this question. Once we love someone, maybe our spouse, our children, our parents, or anyone, isn't here for the person who we love, right? We care, we are worried about the person, we want to help the person who we love. So Islam says that since God loves humanity, he would like to guide humanity. But to guide humanity, Islam says that God does not come down and become a human being. He does not come down and become an idol or any part of the creation. God remains God, but he appoints prophets and messengers. Like Prophet Abraham and Noah, Prophet Jesus and Muhammad, peace be upon all of them. So these were some of the prophets and the messengers who are mentioned in the Quran. And God has appointed them to guide humanity, to bring them to worship the Creator and not the creation. So when Adam was created, when Prophet Adam, when he was created by God, God gave him a very important commandment. Do not eat from any, do not come and eat this apple or this tree from this tree. Do not approach it. Go and enjoy anything else that you want. But we know the story, right? What happened? Somebody deceived Adam and then he made the first mistake. So that is common between the Christian belief, the Jewish belief. But here is a slight difference. Islam says in chapter 2 of the Quran that after Adam and Eve, once they were sent from earth, they repented to God. They first of all, they thought, you know, yes, we made a mistake. Let us repent to God. So they repented to God, and God, according to Islam, forgave their sins. So what they have committed, Islam says that their sins are not passed down towards their children and to the rest of the generations. So in Islam, we don't believe in original sin, but what we believe is in original goodness. We say that each single child is born, each single baby is born without any blemish, without any sin, pure and innocent, like a clean slate. After they reach the age of puberty, That's when, if they commit, if they make any wrong choices, that's when sins would be added. But if they ask for forgiveness, sins would be forgiven. So that's a very important concept, that what we believe about the very first human beings, Adam and Eve. So it says in the Quran, chapter 16, verse number 36, at different places, that God gave initially a very important commandment to Prophet Adam. And that commandment was, submit yourself to worship one God, submission to one God. Do not worship humans, do not worship idols, do not worship the sun, the moon, the creation, but only worship the one creator. As humanity was increasing all over the world, God appointed prophets and messengers from the human beings. And God gave the same commandment as God gave to Prophet Adam. Invite your people to worship one God, not worshiping the creation, but the creator. So that concept, my dear friends, in Islam is submission to one God. In Arabic, if you translate that concept, it becomes the word Islam. So we say that Islam is not a new faith. We say that Islam was not started by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. We say that Islam as an ideology, as a concept, submission to one God, was given to Prophet Adam, and Abraham came with that same concept. So did Jesus and all the prophets, including the last one, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So that is, in a nutshell, what Islam is, if we go back to history. So for that reason, when I asked that question and she got the right answer, that God is the one who gave the guidance of Islam to humanity, and Islam does not have a founder. Not Muhammad, peace be upon him, and none of the prophets, peace be upon all of them. Here are some of the names of the prophets and the messengers who are mentioned in the Quran. As you can see up here, the very first one is Prophet Adam, and the last one is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, right? So the stories of these prophets, the miracles of these prophets, and especially the message of these prophets are mentioned in the Quran, in many, many places. No Muslim can be a Muslim if they deny and believe in any one of these prophets. That means I cannot say that, you know, I don't want to believe in Jesus because he's a prophet or he's a person of the Christians. If I say that, I cannot be a Muslim. So for example, for Prophet Abraham, his stories are mentioned so many times in the Quran. So in fact, he's mentioned 69 times in the Quran, by the way. With love and admiration, his miracles, his challenges, and especially his message. 3 verse number 69. That Abraham was neither a Jew nor a Christian, but he was a Hanif, he was a Muslim. Because he was worshipping the one creator. When it comes to Prophet Moses and Noah and Jesus, peace be upon him, the Quran says in chapter 42, verse number 13, that the same way of life given to you, Muhammad, peace be upon him, was also given to Noah, Abraham, Moses, and Jesus. That we should worship one God and not get divided amongst ourselves. When it comes to Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, the Quran says in chapter 3, verse number 51, so this is Jesus being quoted in the Quran by God. So this is the quotation in English. Verily, Allah or God is my God and your God. Worship him alone, and that is the right path. So that is what Quran teaches, that that was the message of Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him. And then Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, came with that same message. So Muslims, we love, we honor, and we respect each single one of the prophets to such an extent that we name our sons and daughters with the names of the prophets. I mean our sons, especially. So I have 2 sons up there, right? One is named Yusuf, who is up there, is a 3-year-old. And the second one is named Ibrahim, is Abraham, right? So Joseph and Ibrahim. And some of our children, we name them after Mary, who is the mother of Jesus. So we also respect and honor her to such a degree. It says in the Quran about Mary, chapter 3, verse number 42. An angel was sent by God to Mary, and the angel is saying this to Mary. Mary, not the mother, not the daughter, not the wife of Muhammad, peace be upon him. So Islam admires, respects Jesus and Mary and the rest of the prophets, and that is the commonality that you and us that we have. And I always say this to our fellow Americans, to our neighbors, that when we look into Islam, the Quran, and the Old Testament, and the New Testament, I would say that there are 85% of the things which are in common between us and you. 85% of the things which are common. So it is a teaching of Islam that we should work on the commonalities. Rather than the differences and fight over the differences, we should work on the commonalities to make the society based upon morality and justice for all, and that is one of the teachings of Islam. Alright, let's go to... Why can't we go to the next slide? Is it saying that, you know, Sameer, you're speaking for too long? There you go. All right. They're back. So in a nutshell, what Islam means, God. And once a person or a society submits to God, that's how we can have peace. You know, just like in the classroom, and we have some of the teachers over here, just imagine if there is no teacher in the class and people are just having chaos, right? They're like listening to music and throwing paper planes and eating and all of these. It will be chaos sometimes if there is no teacher or if there is a substitute teacher, right? If people do not obey society or obey the teacher or the professor, it will not be a structured classroom. In the same way, what Islam says is, if all of us obeys the Creator, worships Him alone, follow God's guidance, there will be justice, equality, and peace all over the world. So let's take a small commercial break upon him. When they used to introduce Muhammad, peace be upon him, to somebody who's new to the place, they used to say that here is our citizen, Muhammad, peace be upon him. He's the most truthful and he's the most honest. Those were the criteria given to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He was a role model for the society, never spoke any lies, never broke any promises. So he was the one. In the year 610, he became a prophet. God appointed him to be as a prophet. And he delivered the same message to the people as the message of Prophet Abraham and Prophet Jesus and Prophet Moses. That is the message of absolute oneness of God. So I'm going to wrap up the presentation by presenting to you the six beliefs and the five pillars, right? Some of you may know those. Pastor Mike, you know them, right?
Yes, but I left the notes at home.
You're supposed to memorize, not from the notes. Islam has six beliefs and five pillars. The six beliefs are, we believe in the absolute oneness of God, that God is only one, He alone we should worship. The second one is to believe that God has created angels, and angels are assigned certain duties. For example, Angel Gabriel. He is assigned to bring the revelation from God to different prophets. Then we believe in all the divine books that God has sent down to guide humanity. So we say that a book was given to Prophet David, Prophet Moses, Prophet Jesus, and some scrolls were given to Prophet Abraham, peace be upon him. As Muslims, we were supposed to believe in all of those divine books which were given to all of those prophets and the messengers in their original form. And lastly, we believe in the last book, which is the Quran, given to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So one small footnote about the Quran is, God says in the Quran that God is the one who has given this Quran, and God is the one who is going to protect it from it getting altered, it getting lost, it getting changed. So you'll be surprised to find out that now today, in the world, there are no less than 10 million Muslims who memorize the whole Quran. Quran is not a small book, by the way. I mean, when you look at your gift bag, Quran is a book that has 6,000 plus passages in there. So there are people right in this room too, by the way, and I see one person sitting up there, and there could be some more up here who memorized the whole book from the first page to the last page in the original Arabic. My son, my three-year-old son, he knows certain passages of the Quran. He memorized it in Arabic. My seven-year-old son, along with some other youth, some Muslim youth sitting up there, they memorize certain chapters of the Quran in Arabic language. And if you tell them to come and recite, they will recite it perfectly without making mistakes. So that's one of the beauties and that's one of the miracles of the Quran, is that Quran has been protected by God in the hearts and the minds of people. And last but not the least about the Quran, some of you are professors and some of you are, you know, teachers over here. Quran, of the 6,000 plus passages in the Quran, no less than 500 of those passages, they speak about the modern scientific facts. That how did the universe begin? How does the fetus grow inside the mother's womb? What is the shape of the world? Right? About embryology, about anatomy, about physiology, about chemistry, about mathematics, about cosmology, astronomy. Quran has 500 plus scientific facts and zero mistakes when it comes to the modern discoveries and the inventions that we have. Number five, we believe that this life is a short life. We all have to die one day, as people have died before us. But after we die, God is going to bring us back to life, and we'll be standing in front of God. And God is going to ask us, what kind of a belief that you held, and what kind of deeds that you did. So based upon if the person has the right belief and doing good deeds, then God, by his mercy, not by the deeds of the person, by the way, but by God's mercy, that person becomes eligible to go to eternal paradise. And I hope and pray that all of us, right, go to eternal paradise by having the right belief and good deeds. On the flip side of it, God says in the Quran, chapter number 4, verse number 116, and in different places, that if anyone dies by associating partners with God, means worshipping a creation instead of the dead, that means there would be consequences, and Islam does say that there would be hellfire. And I hope and pray that none of us goes there. We all worship one God and doing good deeds. And the last belief is that anything that happens anywhere in the whole universe, it is by the will, the power, and the wisdom of God. Let me end with the five pillars of Islam. I want to ask you this question, right? Who knows the five pillars of Islam? No, not you. Come on. She's raising her hand. Okay, who amongst the guests over here knows the five pillars? Pastor Mike? I'm going to pick on you.
Do I have right here?
Yeah, oh, no, you have the name of there. Come on. Thank you. Okay, one of them is we have to fast in the month of fasting, right? So that's one pillar. What else do you think are the four of almsgiving, right? So it's very important to give charity in Islam. 2.5% of our saved wealth for 1 year. It is not an option. It is not something good. It's an obligation. To help the poor, the needy, the homeless, it's one of the pillars of Islam. Three more. Go to Mecca, yes. Once in a lifetime, Muslims are obligated to go to Mecca, do the two more.
If they can afford.
If they could afford, yes.
Prayer.
You know, you saw prayer today. Yes, and the very first one is? You could read from there now, you have it in front of you. Believe in God. That means to testify that I believe that there is only one God, Allah, and I believe and I testify that Muhammad is the messenger of God. Once a person believes these things, that's how a person becomes a Muslim. So let me end my presentation by saying that there are 1.7 billion Muslims, 2.2 billion Christians, 1.3 billion atheists and agnostics. There is only one Trump, by the way. Yes. We are not going anywhere. All is our home. So let's work together to build on the commonalities that we have, and there are so many commonalities. Let's build on our humanity. Let's build as being neighbors. Let's work together, putting some differences aside. Let's come on the commonalities. So each one of us working together and as a society. We could build societies which are based upon morality, which are based upon justice, which are based upon equality and peace for all. Thank you very much. many things, but I want you to ask those questions.
Family and youth issues. And has given several presentations on the basics of Islam at different universities throughout the Chicagoland area. Joining her will be Brother Hisham and Dr. Sabil Ahmed for the Q&A. As a panel for the Q&A. Please allow me to welcome our guest speakers on stage.
I was just wondering if in the Quran, if there is another coming of a new messenger at some point, someday, is there any mention of this? Or is it that you believe that Muhammad is the final?
So with regards to revelation, Islam believes we're having revealed many prophets from the beginning of time until the end of time. The final prophet and the seal of all prophets, we believe to be the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, that he is the final prophet. There is reference to a second coming of the Prophet Jesus, or the Messiah, that he will be brought back. It's our belief as well that he never
actually died, that the Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, will return close to the end of time, and that will be one of the signs, actually, of the Day of Judgment, that the Prophet Jesus will return, at which point the other elements to the Day of Judgment will start to arise.
Thank you.
Different dress for men and women. I noticed in the prayer service that some men wore what I would call traditional headgear. Some had no head covering, and women. What is the significance of the dress?
Different types of clothes that we wear. For men, you're talking about the way the sheikh is worn, his towel with the kufi on top, or I'm wearing my hijab. So to answer that question, Islam emphasizes a lot on chastity and modesty. And this is applicable for both men and women. So the number one reason where I wear my hijab is because it's the commandment of my Lord. He has asked me to do it, and I do it because I trust him. And once you build that trust, then you obey, and then you know that in there's some benefit. And the benefit that I wear my hijab is because I don't want people to mistreat me because of my looks, or because of the shape of my body, or depending on how much makeup I have, or what I want people to look at me as for who I am, for my intellect, for my actions, for how I treat others, not for my physical aspects. So women are asked to cover so that men do not abuse women, men do not treat women as objects of pleasure, and then just walk away. No, that does not mean that I cover it in my house. In my house, just like regular people, I do have hair. And I do not take a shower with my hijab, neither do I sleep with my hijab. So it's just when I go out of my comfort zone and I know there could be people who will misuse me, that's when I wear the hijab. According to the men, this is how people used to dress at that time. And there is no restriction on the color or the type of clothing. But the restriction is on it should be not form-fitting, it should not be transparent, it should not be so glamorous that it attracts the opposite gender. So does that answer your question?
Is it a commandment or is it for attire?
Yes, it is an order from God, and different attire, like I said, there is no compulsion on color, it should be, as long as it does not, it's loose-fitting and it does not, you know, stick to your figure. That's the requirement. So no compulsion on color and the fabric or anything of that sort.
Thank you.
And then you say that the people are from all over the world. Does everyone have to learn Arabic to be part of it? Or is that just like one of the teachings for the children that you learn Arabic?
So So the question was with regards to learning Arabic and being able to speak Arabic with all Muslims. Is that correct? Understanding
yes.
of the question?
Yes.
So it is not required to learn Arabic or to even be able to speak Arabic. The Arabic language is a matter of preservation of the faith. So as we said, that the book of Allah that we believe to be the Quran, the revelation as it was revealed 1400 plus years ago, is recited exactly the same in the native language from that time, we believe, until the end of the world. So that Arabic language preservation is part of the faith. However, like you said, you know, there are billions or millions and millions of Muslims who do not speak Arabic whatsoever. They aren't able to recite it, and this is actually one of the miracles of the Quran, that it can be memorized by people who are not native speakers of Arabic. It's one of the miracles of the Quran that you can recite it in that language. And there are multiple translations or interpretations of the meanings of the Quran in languages of the world, so that people can still get the message of the book without having to learn the language itself. So Arabic language is a means of preservation. It is not a necessity in order to practice Islam or to become a Muslim. Any questions?
Awesome. Thanks for having us here. I just want to know, aside from open houses and meeting with your neighbors and stuff, how else is your community dealing with some of the unfair portrayal, on mass media and pop culture and dealing with that?
Okay, so the question is about how. This is not the only open house, by the way. We have done open houses in Naperville Masjid, in the Naperville Mosque. About 1,000 people came there. Yeah, 1,000 people, right? So people want to know what Islam is. They want to work with the Muslim community. We want to work with each other. So this is one thing. Second thing that we are doing is we are giving opportunity to our fellow Americans, our neighbors, our colleagues, through advertisement like in the CNN and the Fox, that we had the 30-second ads. We have ads in the newspapers. We have ads on the Facebook, social media, different places to connect with the Muslims and to learn what Islam is and what Islam is not. Number third important thing is, Islam speaks a lot about doing good actions. And joining good and forbidding evil is one of the main obligations of Muslims. So there are many Muslim relief organizations. Like in this mosque itself, we have the soup kitchen. We have the catering to the poor, the needy, and the homeless. People come there for financial support in different ways. So we want to show by good actions that this is what Islam is. We have free health clinics in many, many mosques. And we are working with other faith-based groups for charity and for humanitarian and for relief efforts. And last but not the least, we have, there are 7 million Muslims in the USA. We are calling out Muslims. So we are having a 1 million Muslim voters drive. All right? So this is, thank you. We're having 1 million Muslim voters drive to vote, to come out and cast the vote.
Voters drive.
Oh, yes.
Good.
You can appreciate that, yes. That's something good, right? As a citizen, that's our right to make the decision. Now, it's very important that we are all in this together, by the way. This is what Muslims are doing. But what can you do? As our fellow neighbors, people of other faith traditions, what can you do? At least you could mention to your neighbors, to your colleagues, and to your family who is not here, that we went to the mosque and we learned about what Islam is and what Islam is not. We connected with the Muslims, and Muslims are good people. I hope you could say that, right? Come on. Right. You could also, have the Facebook ads about what Islam is, what Islam is not. We could work with each other, this mosque and other churches and other such institutions. We could work together in the political system, in the economic system, in the educational system, in the relief. There are so many opportunities that we have that we could work together. So we all have our responsibilities, both as Muslims and people of other faiths, both as individuals and people of institutions. So let's work together. We are all in here together, as I mentioned. We want to create societies which are better for all of us. Since we are all in this together, let's take this first move. This is not the only time, hopefully, that all of you are here. Let's come together in here, in the churches, in public libraries. So let's have projects together to make the society better. Thank you.
I think it's very important. A lot of us are so confused on it, and I'm sure you are yourselves on, I even hate to say it, ISIS, the horrible thing, and it's unfortunate that, you know, so many see it as your beliefs. Do you know what I'm trying to say? Or do you follow what I'm saying? I think that is just so sad. And how do we overcome that? I mean, I guess what you're doing here, but that just, that really bothers me. I hate to see them thinking the same thing.
So that's a concern, that what some groups may be doing out there, and that is painting all of Islam and all of Muslims with the same brush, that is what Islam stands for, according to some media, some groups, and some people. So it's important for us to realize that there are 1.7 billion Muslims, and those groups, they are like so negligible when you look into the percentage of people who are doing this, number one. Number two, it's very, very important that people, they could use Arabic terminology and Arabic concepts and taking words and passages out of the Quran, or the Bible for that matter, and for their own political agenda or their own ideological agenda, even though they may contradict the clear-cut teachings of what Islam says. For example, this is the Quran, chapter number 2, verse number 190. The translation is, fight in the cause of God for those who fight against you. Means if somebody is imposing war on you, as a self-defense, yes, you could fight, you could protect yourself. But even in that self-defense fight, so the Quran, I'm quoting the Quran again, God is saying that do not go to extreme, because God does not love the extremist. I'm quoting the Quran. God does not love the extremist. So the Quran is saying that yes, you have a God-given right to protect yourself and your families and your honor if somebody is imposing and trying to compromise your life. You know, just like, for example, if two aliens bang on the door, and when you look out there, you see some, you know, people out there, gang members trying to threaten you, your family, your wife, your daughter, and your children. Obviously, you're going to call the police. You're going to have the ADT, you'll press it so it could go to the police too. And you will also pick up your baseball bat. Don't you? Come on. Just in case if they come in, at least you want to protect yourself. So Islam is saying that yes, in a self-defense fight, you could protect yourself. But Islam is very careful. It says, do not go to any extreme, even in their self-defense. So what are some of the criteria of self-defense protection? It says in the Quran, chapter 5, verse number 32, that taking one innocent life is like taking the life of all of humanity. Saving one innocent life is like saving the life of all of humanity. So this is what Islam teaches. That doesn't matter, even in a just war, yes, you have the God-given right, but make sure that you do not touch and you do not kill innocent life. And that innocent life is not limited to Muslims. It could be an innocent Jew, innocent Christian, innocent atheist. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, after one of his defensive battles, you know, at that time they used to compromise the Muslim state that was formed by Muhammad, peace be upon him. The people, they want to come and dismantle it and destroy the Muslims, the nation, and the life and the property. So Muhammad, peace be upon him, in a defensive war, after the war was done, he saw a woman dead on the ground, and he became angry. He became very sad that who killed this innocent person. He called his companions and he told them, even in a war, do not kill women and children. That means Muslims, we cannot harm, we cannot touch, and we cannot kill innocent people. And that is what Islam teaches. So Islam is so careful that there is no such thing in Islam, despite what Ted Cruz says. There is no carpet bombing in Islam, by the way. There is no Hiroshima and Nagasaki in Islam. Even if the enemy destroys and harms your innocent people, even then Islam does not give Muslims to touch, harm, or kill their innocent people. And that is what Islam teaches. Very important. And if the enemy says, peace, if they incline towards peace, the Quran says in chapter 8, verse number 61, that you Muslims, you also incline towards peace. That means do not shoot them in the back, incline towards peace, shake hands and have a peace treaty, and that is what Islam teaches. So in case, if you see some misguided Muslims out there going against the clear-cut teachings of the Quran and the noble example of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, it is their shortcomings. They're taking things out of context. It is their emotions overruling their logic, superseding the clear-cut teachings, the gold standard, which is the Quran. So Quran teaches to safeguard human life. Every life is precious, every blood is precious, every soul is equal. So for that reason, when we condemn the bombing in Brussels, we should equally condemn the innocent lives which are taken in Yemen, in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Mali. And 26 people died in bombing in Iraq. So with the same brush, we have to condemn all the killings. Life is precious, and that is what Islam teaches.
Suicide is considered a major sin, and the punishment for the one who takes their own life or harms themselves, that's the teaching of Islam in the Quran directly from the Word of Allah. I'm sure there's a follow-up question to that. I'm waiting for you to ask.
We teach next door, and we have a lot of Muslim students, and often with the rhetoric that's going on in this current campaign, we have students that come to us and are concerned, our Muslim students, about particular candidates getting elected or the potential for them. And I just kind of want to know, what would you suggest? We've talked and we kind of have our way of trying to calm the concerns of these students and things like that, but is there any other thoughts you could give us as to how to try to calm those concerns and to support those students as much as anything?
So we deal with a lot of that as well. You know, a lot of our youth feeling disenfranchised, you know, people feeling bullied with regards to, you know, the way their last name sounds or the skin color or their country heritage of their parents, even though a lot of Muslims in this room I know for sure were born and raised in this Chicagoland area itself. So the advice that I give to a lot of our young people and Muslims in general, that the most American thing you can do is to continue being your Muslim self. You know, the way that this country was founded was the fact of religious freedom. So to hide your Islamic identity or to try to, you know, just to slide by and just to fit in or to whitewash or to just, you know, just to get by and leaving your Islamic identity is the most un-American thing that we as Muslims can do. Rather, holding on to our patriotic sense of America the Great, being a Muslim and maintaining my Islamic identity and being different, right, that's the most American thing that I can do. So hanging on to that really gives a lot of support and gives a lot of comfort to a lot of our young people that are feeling marginalized by the America that, you know, we grew up in, that we were born in, we've been raised in, we've contributed to, we pay taxes to, we pay all the, right? We're involved in this the same as everyone else. So being as Muslim as you can is the most American thing that we as Muslims can do.
Answers to these two questions. Can you clarify the concept about Sharia law and the concept about jihad?
Sharia law, in a nutshell, it means a guidance. It's a how-to manual that God has given to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So Sharia law is a guidance. It's a how-to manual. You know, when we go and take a driving test, it's a how-to manual for how to drive. When we go to schools and colleges, you have how-to manual for the students. When you go to a new place of work, we have a how-to manual for the employees. So Sharia law is a how-to manual of how we as human beings should live, as individually and as society. Now, if I ask you this question, what's your mind when you hear the word Sharia law? Just be honest, right? Just speak your heart.
Oppression?
Oppression and what else?
Caliphate.
Caliphate, and how about this and how about that, right? So, the very first thing that comes to the mind is the punishment system, right? Cutting, chopping, things of that nature. So let me just give an analogy to all of you. Suppose if people from Mars, if they come and they ask me the question, you know, Brother Sabil, what is the US Constitution about? If I tell them that the US Constitution is, it kills people, that's all I say, and then they leave. Have I done justice to the US Constitution?
No.
No, I have not. Come on, I have not, right? I have left out the breadth and the beauty of the US Constitution. The benefits it provides to the people, the equality it speaks about, the services it provides to the young and the old. I have left out the breadth and the beauty of the US Constitution. Even though what I mentioned, it was like 0.5% of what US Constitution is about. In the same way, under the breadth and the beauty and the umbrella of the Sharia law, is less than 0.5%. Means every society, we need to have the checks and balances. We have the police force, we have the armed forces, that there should be checks and balances. So in the same way, under the Sharia law of the Quran, there are no less than 15 passages that speaks about the punishment system. The rest of the six, it speaks about how can we peacefully connect with God, that is part of the Sharia law. Honoring our parents, that's part of the Sharia law. Having mercy to the young and respecting the older people, that's part of the Sharia law. Giving charity is part of the Sharia law. Me smiling at you is part of, we are connecting with you, you having lunch, you're listening over here, you're educating, that's part of the Sharia law. So Sharia law is God's guidance that God has given to Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Now Sharia law given to Muhammad, peace be upon him, is not the only Sharia law. Sharia law or God's guidance was also given to the previous prophets and the messengers, for example. The Ten Commandments, which are there in the Old Testament, Exodus chapter 20, it speaks about the guidance given to the Jewish people, and we say that that was the Sharia law given to Prophet Moses and his people. When Prophet Jesus, when he came and he said that I came not to destroy the law or the prophets, I came to fulfill, Matthew chapter 5, verse number 17, we say that Jesus came to fulfill and to approve the Sharia law given to Prophet Moses, peace be upon him. So Sharia law, in a nutshell, it is God's guidance of how we can live as individuals, peacefully, proactively, engaging, and enhancing the society. When we speak about equality in the Constitution, that all people are equal, that's what the Sharia law preaches. It says in the Quran, chapter number, it says, actually Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he mentioned, that all humanity, if an Arab person is no superior to a non-Arab person. A non-Arab is no superior to an Arab. A white person is no superior to a black person. A black person is no superior to a white person. Children of Adam, and Adam was made from dust. That's what Sharia law preaches. So when you saw up there on the slides that Muslims were making institutions of higher learning, they were practicing the Sharia law. When Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, when he moved from Makkah to Medina and he gave the Jewish people up there the autonomy, that they could have the freedom to practice their faith and have the synagogues and they could have their culture. He gave them the autonomy, the freedom, he was practicing the Sharia law. When Muslims, when they pulled out the Jews from getting oppressed by certain people, as it says in the JewishChronicle.com, it says up there, that Muslims helped the Jewish people from getting extinct two times in history. Muslims were practicing the Sharia law when they helped the Jewish cousins. So anything which you see up there, which is there from the Quran, from the example of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, that is benefiting the society, benefited the society, helping the neighbors, taking care of the poor, the needy, the homeless, all of these are part of the Sharia law. What is not part of the Sharia law is very important. If anyone is forcefully converting someone and saying that this is part of the Sharia law, actually they are going against the Sharia law. The Quran teaches verse number 256, that there is no compulsion in faith. Means a person could have a freedom of choice what they want to believe in. But if someone is forcefully converting in the name of the Sharia law, they're going against the Sharia law. If someone is oppressing the women, saying that this is part of the Sharia law, no, that is culture. Here is the gold standard Quran teaches. If somebody is oppressing the minorities, doesn't matter in Iraq and different places, they're going against the Sharia law. So in a nutshell, Sharia law came as a guidance for individual and for humanity, so we could worship the Creator and we can form societies based upon justice and equality for all, and that is the Sharia law. If anyone disagrees, those people out there, they're actually going against the clear-cut teachings of the Sharia law. That's what it means, yes. Thank you. The common misconceptions people have. As soon as I came up on the stage, I apologized to them, saying that, you know, I'm sorry, I'm 10 minutes late doing jihad. I told them, fighting the Chicago traffic, that was jihad for me, right? Jihad has four steps, or four different categories. Number one is the very first S, is to self-purify yourself. Means you have to struggle the best in the eyes of God. So that striving, that struggling on constant basis, that is the first form of jihad. So jihad means you're constantly strengthening yourself to inculcate all that is good and to repel all that is evil. Suppose if the person is smoking and drinking and backbiting and lying and cheating, now the person says that is wrong, it's not easy. He has to fight within himself. That fight, the inner fight to become good in the eyes of God, that is the first form of jihad. The second form, well, let me just say, when the sisters, when the ladies, when they go out, they see all this staring and verbally physical abuse sometimes, they're actually doing jihad each single day when they're going out in the public. The second form of jihad, society. To engage with the society and to better the society. For example, suppose if some people are doing good in the society, like they're having walks for breast cancer, for autism, and for all of these educational means, if Muslims are taking part in that, they're taking part in jihad. If I'm standing, and there are all these falsehoods and misconceptions which are out there, I'm actually using my tongue to do jihad. Jihad by the pen, jihad by your resources, your finances, your time, to make the society better. The third form of jihad is the third S, which is self-defense. As I explained before, if someone is imposing war on you, defend yourself. In that defense, you have to be careful not to harm, not to touch, and not to compromise anyone's life, means innocent life. So that is the third form of jihad. The fourth form of jihad is the last S, which is to save saving lives. So it says in the Quran, chapter number 4, verse number 75. Why don't you fight in the cause of God for those people who are oppressed? Their people are compromising them, taking away their freedoms. Go and remove the oppression from them. So that is the fourth form of jihad. So jihad at the end of the day, self and in the society, to make the society better, more peaceful, more just, and more equal for each single one of us. War. There is no concept of holy war in Islam. Actually, the word for holy war, if you translate that into Arabic, it is harb muqaddasa. Harb muqaddasa, right? Arabic for holy war. Those words you will never find anywhere in the 6,000 plus passages in the Quran. Holy war is outside of the concept of Islam. You will never find those words uttered by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So if some people are using those words, holy war, and they're destroying properties, people, persons, they're actually going against what jihad came for. Jihad is not oppressing of women. Actually, jihad came to liberate the women and to give them the equal status, equal to man in the eyes of God. If some people using jihad and they're forcefully converting the people, they're going against what jihad came for. So jihad at the end of the day Listen to this. It came to fight terrorism. Jihad is the enemy of terrorism. Jihad is the opposite of terrorism. So jihad came to struggle to be the best in the eyes of God. So working together, we could form societies based upon God's guidance, which is good for us, good for justice, equality, and peace for all. And that is what jihad is.
By like the Muslim diet, like the cans and canats of the Muslim diet, why we don't eat certain things and what we do eat and drink. That'd be great. Thank you.
That we eat. Right? So with regards to modesty and how we eat, we're talking about portion size. So that's, you know, first and foremost, you know, something that can really help you know, physiologically. We have Dr. Samil here that can speak a little bit more to that from a health benefit. With regards to some of the restrictions in terms of Islamic diet, I know some of the Willowbrook staff were talking to me a bit earlier about, you know, some of their students, they don't get involved. I give this presentation a lot of times to schools, and teachers tend to ask me, well, when we have green eggs and ham day, the Muslim students kind of shy away from it, and they're not sure why. So pork is one of the items that's not allowable according to Islamic dietary regulations. Alcohol is not allowed in accordance with Islamic dietary regulations, which, you know, one of my degrees is in Judaic studies, as you heard in my bio, which is also the same in Jewish and Christian faiths as well, with regards to eating of pork. But you can ask Pastor Mike about that. He'll have more information than I will. To that regards, with regard to what is actually permissible or what is impermissible, it would be pork, it would be alcohol, and those things which are not taken in the name of God when they are prepared. So those are simple rundown as far as Islamic dietary regulations.
Context. In the context of what happened in our backyard at the Wheaton College, a lot of times these questions are coming up, especially from our friends and Christian neighbors. Do Muslims and Christians worship the same God? So if you'd like to address that one, I would really appreciate it.
I, as a Muslim, don't want to be brushed in the same stroke as the other 1.7 billion Muslims. I'm sure the same is true for Christians as well, that there's many different belief systems within the Christian faith also. It's not a unanimous, okay, all Catholics believe the exact same as Protestants, believe the exact same as Mormons, believe the exact same as Jehovah's Witnesses, believe the exact same. It wouldn't be fair, right, to brush everybody's Christian faith in the same paint, as it would not be fair to brush every Muslim's faith and practice in the same paint neither. Generally speaking, it is the Islamic belief that God is one, which is unto humanity using prophets who were attached to people of the Christian faith who followed the Christ, right? People of the Jewish faith who followed Judea, or the prophet of the son of Abraham, and the Muslims who followed the prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. The root message was the same, the oneness of God. And from that, God commanded. So the oneness of God is prevalent in all of our faith traditions. With that, I would like to thank everyone again for having come, the wonderful questions. I know there's a billion other questions that people may have. We may not have had an opportunity to address, and I do apologize for that. I do request your forgiveness if there is any means that we did not fulfill your rights as guests. Now, we do want some individuals, everybody got a feedback form. So if there was something in the program that you really like or something that you even didn't really like, let us know so that the next time we will be able to fulfill your rights a little bit better. If you did not get a feedback form, please do feel free to ask any of our volunteers and they'll be happy to give you that. It's 0 to 5, you know, did you like this, did you not like that, kind of feedback form. Also, before you leave, we are requesting some individuals to give testimonials. So if you have a few seconds, just to sit on a video and share your thoughts on the program, share your concerns about the community. We will be having an opportunity to do that as well. You can see Brother Jawed, he is our camera guy. And one more thing that I would actually request is, I really want to imprint this memory on at least my mind and my community's mind. So if you guys don't mind taking a picture with me, I have a corny question. But we'll have our panelists up here as well, so in just a minute, maybe we've got the camera right up there already set up. Come on up and let's just take a group photo before everybody splits up. And don't forget, we do have gift bags as well, so everybody make sure to take one of those before you head.
Sam, I'm very happy that I came today. It was very informative, and I think it's so sad that our media, some media, gives us total wrong idea and impression of what being a Muslim is, and I guess that's all I have to say. Thank you.
It's important, I think, to open up your mind and understand where the different cultures are coming from. And it's important because we're all in one world. So it's important for people to, as they had said, accent the things that we have in common and to support the society in a positive environment. So when I leave here, I feel much more informed and educated about what's going on and kind of the Islamic beliefs. And it was good. It was very good.
Thank you for the opportunity to come out, for us to come here, and we really enjoyed the opportunity to learn more about the Muslim community in our community, and especially we're teaching next door. It's good to know how we can help support our fellow members of our community and our students in order to make this a better place to live, just in general.
Thank you for having us out.
Thank you.